Michael Jackson and his skyrocketing career eventually made him the highest paid entertainer in the world. As his colossal earnings increased, so did his flamboyant lifestyle as he spent lavishly to keep up with his king of pop image. But living so ostentatiously in the public eye left Jackson vulnerable to opportunists, looking to take advantage of his extreme riches. From multi-million dollar demands and endless court dramas as his personal net worth increased, so did the cost of just existing as Michael Jackson. This continual assault, bad business dealings, and reckless spending eventually outstripped his enormous income as his pop star heyday waned. Accumulating monstrous levels of debt, Michael Jackson was almost too big to fail. Unthinkable for someone so successful, famous, and powerful could ever lose it all. In this series of videos, we hope to, in some estimation, uncover the numbers behind Michael Jackson's complex finances. From his royalty checks to numerous business dealings, endorsement payouts, and outlandish expenses, revealing the truth behind Michael Jackson's colossal bank account. Here's the detail. By the summer of 1993, the world-class entertainer was estimated by Forbes magazine to be worth more than $150 million, or $317.3 million when adjusted for inflation, with earnings from the last year amounting to $42 million, or $91 million today. However, when news broke of child molestation allegations, just as Jackson was beginning the second leg of his dangerous world tour, his financial good fortune began to take a turn. Relentless hounding by the world press as the salacious story developed left Michael in a spiraling personal and public image nightmare. This scandal eventually resulting in the cancellation of the rest of the Dangerous World Tour due to Michael Jackson's deteriorating health and desperate need for treatment for a dependency on prescription drugs. The personal nightmare also had its financial ramifications. Soon after Jackson's announcement, Pepsi made their own statement cutting ties with the superstar after 10 years of multi-million dollar endorsement deals. PepsiCo spokesman Gary Hemphill said that the only agreement they had with Jackson was to sponsor this particular international tour. Quote, "The cancellation really effectively cancels our relationship with Michael right now," Hemphill commented. Quote, "We just hope he is able to resolve his problems." Although after this decision, Pepsi never worked with Michael Jackson again. Aside from corporate sponsors, canceling the tour incited its promoters to take legal action against the performer in the tune of $20 million, $42.3 million today. Arguing that an addiction to drugs is not a good enough reason for those invested to lose out, claiming Michael Jackson was dependent on drugs well before the tour contract was negotiated and signed. The lawsuit claimed breach of contract, fraud, fraudulent concealment, negligent misrepresentation, and conspiracy to defraud. Quote, "My client has given Mr. Jackson more than $2 million in advances, $900,000 alone for the days he canceled," the case's lawyer said. In addition to advance money for private jets, stadium rental, and setup personnel, although no more was reported on this case, Michael likely dealt with the matter out of court, incurring the cost of settling and hefty legal bills in the process. The tour's cancellation also had many questioning whether Michael Jackson's ultimate goal was in jeopardy, to raise an incredible $100 million, $211.5 million when adjusted for inflation, for his Heal the World Foundation. The organization did indeed build playgrounds, provided immunizations, and funded scores of children's causes around the world. It helped pay for a Hungarian boy's life-saving liver transplant and co-sponsored an airlift of more than 46 tons of relief supplies to war-torn Bosnia-Herzegovina in 1992. Although it never reached the pop star's lofty fundraising goal, the foundation reportedly doled out about $4 million, or $8 million today, said its former director Richard Fowler. However, Jackson effectively abandoned the foundation by the mid-90s and never made any more serious attempts to fundraise for his charity past this point. Aside from the loss of earnings Michael Jackson suffered as a result of the child molestation claims, their legal ramifications also took a significant hit on his finances, the most publicized expense being the $23 million, or $47.4 million when adjusted for inflation, settlement Jackson agreed as part of the civil lawsuit, $5 million, or $10.3 million today, of which was to pay their lawyers' fees, giving us an insight that if the accusers incurred legal costs amounting several million dollars, you could only imagine how much Michael Jackson was paying for legal representation. In fact, he was advised to settle the case, in part because it was the cheaper option when compared to going to court and the additional colossal costs that would occur. However, the multi-million dollar payout didn't curb Michael's sky-high legal expenses. It actually encouraged countless others to come out of the woodwork and push Jackson for lottery-level settlements of their own. The landslide of cases kept the superstar's world-class legal team busy for years to come. With Jackson now point-blank refusing to pay off those with baseless claims looking to extort money from him. Therefore, the only parties to win were the lawyers involved. In 1994, Forbes magazine reported that in the previous year, Michael Jackson had made $38 million, or $78.4 million in dollars today. An incredible amount of money, but due to the astronomical expenses he incurred as a result of the 1993 allegations, this meant that Michael was for the very first time in financial hot water and needed to release some extra cash. Hence, the King of Pop agreed to sign a 5-year contract with EMI Music to manage his music publishing company, ATV Music, in exchange for an advance of $70 million, or $148 million today, against revenue that EMI expected to generate. In addition, EMI agreed to enter into partnership with Jackson and provide him with financing to acquire other music catalogs. In 1995, Michael would leverage his ATV Music catalog once again when Sony offered Jackson $110 million, or $200.6 million today, for a 50% stake in an ATV and Sony Music Publishing joint venture. Jackson essentially sold half of his ownership of the Beatles and other songs for a large profit, Sony ATV becoming the second largest music publisher in the world worth $500 million, the equivalent of $1 billion today. Administrative expertise was provided by Sony, and Jackson was a company director and attended board meetings regularly. As each party in the arrangement held the power of a veto, Michael still remained in control as both sides would have to agree on a decision before it could be made. As a result of the King of Pop's savvy business arrangements, they helped his yearly income, with Forbes magazine reporting in 1996 that the global superstar had earned the previous year approximately $67 million, or $130.5 million today. And the year after, $90 million, $171.4 million today. Aside from publishing, Michael Jackson was keen to get his music career back on track and release another top-selling record. But yet again, the significant profits he made from selling albums were eaten up by his King of Pop demands. Delay after delay, hiring out expensive studio spaces, a record for Michael Jackson demanded the most elaborate of marketing strategies. Predicting sales worth $500 million, much of the $40 million, or $80 million today, spent to promote his latest release, the double album epic History, came from the artist. Jackson himself invested $5 million, or $10 million today, producing a controversial 4-minute album teaser for the project, and spent $7 million, or $14 million today, creating the most expensive music video in all time for its lead single Scream. Within the first year of its release, History reportedly sold over 11 million copies. Impressive by the standards of most pop stars, but well below previous sales by one of the best-selling pop singers of all time. And for the first time ever, Michael Jackson actually lost money releasing new music. This may be why, during a live internet chat, MJ said of History, quote, "This might be my last album I ever do. I will always create music, but I'm not sure if I'll create another album." However, Jackson knew he could earn the big bucks not just from record sales. Accepting an offer of $17 million, or $33.1 million when adjusted for inflation, Michael Jackson agreed to perform to 60,000 guests at the Sultan of Brunei's 50th birthday celebrations in July of 1996. Mere months later, he embarked on the History World Tour. Performing 82 shows over 13 months, History became his highest-grossing tour ever, raking in $165 million. Or $314.3 million today. They were some of the most expensive shows ever staged, but during the tour, just two Sydney stages reaped almost $7 million in ticket sales alone, with merchandising raising another $1 million. It hasn't been reported what cut Michael Jackson took from the world tour, but Forbes estimated in 1997 that the global superstar had earned the year before $55 million, or $104.7 million today. From this period onwards, Michael Jackson fell off the top earning lists as press outlets began to report on his spiraling finances and mounting debts. His spending became increasingly outrageous, which included the $15 million, or $28.5 million today, he coughed up to produce his Ghosts short film. The video epic included elaborate sets, costumes, and cutting-edge special effects, and was released in order to promote what would become his lowest-selling album in decades, 1997's Blood on the Dance Floor. The latter part of the 1990s also characterized by announcements of grand, but ultimately fruitless, business dealings. It was clear that as his musical star faded, he desperately tried to invest in new sources of income. However, several of these ventures went disastrously wrong. Pouring millions into an internet venture called HollywoodTicket.com, the website was meant to offer exclusive backstage concert packages for fans with money to burn. Instead, it crashed and burned itself, and in 2001, its former partners sued Jackson for $25 million, or $42 million today, for what they claim were unpaid fees. Jackson also invested $11 million, or $18.7 million today, into a partnership with his company, Neverland Entertainment and MDP Worldwide Entertainment, to set up a new film production studio which failed to launch. Similarly, Michael Jackson invested heavily in his company, Kingdom Entertainment, which hoped to build and manage family-friendly theme parks, hotels, and other attractions around the world. The venture took a large stake in Landmark Entertainment, a Californian company specializing in the design of theme park rides, and made headlines scouting locations in Detroit, Michigan, and the country of Poland, to name just a few. However, yet again, the ambitious plans never came into fruition. At the same time, the singer continued to spend as if he were still topping the charts like back in the 1980s. His Neverland Ranch annual running costs was said to be costing more than $7 million, or $11.8 million today. Michael's financial salvation could have come in the form of his 2001 studio album Invincible. But with the record's production costing $40 million, or $69 million in today's dollars, was said to be the most expensive album ever made and failed to cover its costs. In 2003, Forbes magazine estimated that Michael Jackson had accumulated debts of over $200 million, or $332 million today, but had a net worth of $350 million, or $581 million today. According to a 2002 suit filed in the Californian Superior Court by Union Finance Investment Corp, seeking unpaid fees and expenses amounting to $12 million, or $20.4 million today, Jackson's borrowing had gotten out of control. 1998 documents showed loans totaling $90 million from Bank of America were nearly exhausted. Jackson later sought additional capital, and by 2000, Jackson had taken out loans totaling $270 million, or $480 million today. Some of the debt was secured using Sony ATV as collateral. Other loans were backed by Neverland and MyJack, a separate music publishing firm comprising of MJ's own music. Quote, "For whatever reason, Michael Jackson is not paying his debts," said Pierce O'Donnell, a leading entertainment finance lawyer. Quote, "He has little or no means of income. He lives off a line of credit." Brett Pulley, who covered Jackson's fortunes for Forbes, said there was, quote, "plenty of anecdotal evidence that Jackson's spending is way out of control." Although his superstar lifestyle was often cited as the main culprit for Jackson's money woes, courthouse dramas that continually followed him also claimed a considerable chunk of his income. However, certain legal bills and court-enforced payouts could have been avoided, including the $1.7 million, or $2.9 million today, awarded to Sotheby's Auction House for paintings Jackson bought, then decided he didn't want, and $5.3 million, or $9 million today, that went to a German concert promoter in a breach of contract suit. Quote, "Michael Jackson has for years been beset by lawsuits," Pulley noted. Quote, "What we see now is his inclination to get out there and fight those suits, which speaks to the idea that the cash isn't there to make things go away." However, publicly, the King of Pop kept up with his mega-rich image, coyly suggesting to interviewer Martin Bashir in the 2003 documentary Living with Michael Jackson that he was worth somewhere around $1 billion. When this film was broadcast on ABC in 2003, it caused major controversy for the artist and eventually led to him being accused of a second round of child abuse allegations, although this time Michael Jackson was determined to fight for his innocence in the courts. After a grueling and lengthy legal battle, Jackson came out of the whole ordeal victorious, but his health and bank balance were left in tatters as a result. Michael Jackson was spending like a billionaire on a millionaire's budget, with reports claiming that the superstar was on the brink of financial collapse. John DeRosso Bryan, a forensic accountant who testified during the pop star's trial, said Jackson spent up to $30 million, or $47 million today, a year more than he earned. Reportedly, the singer dropped $6 million, or $9.4 million today, on one shopping spree in Las Vegas, and the prosecution said in closing arguments he withdraws $1 million, or $1.6 million today, in cash at a time, and pays at least $4 million, or $6.3 million today, in legal bills most years. Legal analysts estimated that Michael Jackson invested up to $10 million, or $15.7 million today, on his legal team for the child abuse trial alone. Bank of America came down hard on Jackson, almost forcing him into bankruptcy proceedings after he fell short of a scheduled payment by about $300,000 for his $270 million, or $423 million today, worth of loans. However, after mounting pressure, Bank of America walked away from the situation, the bank notifying Jackson via fax that they were selling the loan package to Fortress Investment LLC to manage. An obvious solution to mounting debts when you have significant assets is to sell some of them to lower your liabilities. However, quote, he does not want to sell his publishing, so his alternative is to restructure those debts. If able to restructure under favorable terms where the revenues of those assets can service the interest payments, he can handle it. If he can't restructure, he might have to sell a percentage of his publishing, said Forbes editor Brett Pulley. However, Michael Jackson chose not to face reality, so no major financial restructuring took place, and the global icon didn't curb his spending neither. In fact, due to interest payments outstripping his income, his colossal debts were only increasing. Jackson spent his final years living off the generosity of incredibly wealthy individuals he surrounded himself, particularly while living in the Middle East, staying in their hotels, using their luxury cars, and accepting any monetary gifts they might offer, including Brunei's Prince Azim, who in 2007 offered the King of Pop $10 million, or $14.7 million today, just to show up at his 25th birthday party in London. However, this behavior also got Jackson in some legal hot water when the King of Bahrain's son sued the pop star for $7 million, or $10.3 million today. Sheikh Abdullah bin Hamad Al Khalifa filed a breach of contract case, claiming Michael took $7 million as an advance on an album and an autobiography that he never produced. However, Jackson claimed the money was a gift. Al Khalifa also claimed that he paid the superstar $35,000, or $52,000 today, to go towards paying the utility costs at Neverland and another $2.2 million, or $3.2 million today, to cover some of his legal bills from the 2005 child molestation trial. Al Khalifa said he believed the money would be repaid once Jackson's career had recovered. Our last in-depth look at Michael's spiraling finances was revealed as part of court proceedings in 2007. In the documents, forensic accountants claimed Michael Jackson had total assets worth $567.6 million, or $836.8 million today. However, the five-page report also said Jackson now had debts of $331 million, or $488 million today, leaving him with a net worth of $236.6 million, or $348.8 million today. They put a net value on Jackson's 50% stake in the Sony ATV Music Publishing catalog, his most prized asset, at $390.6 million, or $575.9 million today, and claimed the singer had just $668,215 in cash. Michael Jackson's last attempt at turning a new leaf in his finances and resurrecting his legendary career came in 2009. Drowning in debt, now reportedly at $400 million, or $570 million today, the world-class performer fell back on what he knew he could make serious cash on: live performance. Therefore, he agreed to a new 50-date concert series, This Is It, at London's O2 Arena. The shows were reportedly going to earn Michael at least $50 million, or $71 million today, but industry insiders said this could be just the beginning. AEG, the organizers of the concerts, originally proposed a 3-year tour starting in Europe, then traveling to Asia, and finally returning to the United States. Although at that point, Jackson only committed to the O2 engagement. The demand was there for global concert ticket sales exceeding $450 million, or $641 million today. Quote, "You were talking about a guy who could make $500 million a year if he puts his mind to it," Tom Barak, a Californian financier, commented. Quote, "There are very few individual artists who are multi-billion dollar businesses, and he is one." According to its contract with the entertainer, AEG advanced Jackson close to $30 million, or $42.7 million today, which included a $15 million line of credit, a $5 million advance, $7.5 million to cover production costs, and rent for a Holmby Hills mansion. But with his Neverland ranch on the brink of foreclosure, his belongings narrowly stopped from being auctioned, and still with endless multi-million dollar legal dramas looming, the King of Pop tragically passed away mere weeks before he was scheduled to hit the stage once again. But what tangled mess did Michael Jackson leave behind? How did the estate's finances prosper post the artist's demise? And was Michael Jackson worth more dead than alive? all questions that will be answered in next week's video, as we investigate the Michael Jackson estate's financial windfalls, as well as their setbacks in the 14 years since MJ's passing in 2009. Thanks. We'll see you next time.